And hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us today for the Wiser on Wednesday Scarlet Canvas Showcase. While I get my share screen ready, if you would do me a favor and drop in the chat if you feel like you are a beginner or novice with Scarlet Canvas, so you're new to it, or if you're an intermediate user or advanced user, I'd like to just kind of get a feel for who we have in the room today. Thank you. I will keep an eye on the chat here while I get my share screen set up.
So far we have beginners, new. New. We have intermediate.
All right. So we got some new and beginners mostly. For those of you intermediate folks, feel free to ask deeper questions as we go along if what I'm saying is stuff you already know, but there's some sort of tangential question you have related to that, or hang on till the end. We're going to dive into where to find more stuff to learn how to do more things in Canvas, which I think you will all appreciate. And we'll try to leave some time at the end for Q&A too, to address individual questions. So we'll dive in here to the PowerPoint deck. We'll be switching between PowerPoint and some share screens just from Canvas and various resources. So we will get going here. So today we'll talk about what Scarlet Canvas does. So what it does do and what it does not do. And then we'll show a video with a preview of the registration process for participants, including the credit card payment gateway. We will talk about how to create engaging and user-friendly courses, and we will show you how to learn how to do more in Canvas using the Canvas resources that are available. So first off, what does Scarlet Canvas do? So Scarlet Canvas will host free or fee-based courses to the public. The beauty of Scarlet Canvas versus our internal Canvas system referred to as Carmen Canvas is that Scarlet Canvas supports user accounts for anyone with a valid email address. It does not need to be an Ohio State name dot number. So that's been really handy for our public facing courses for 4-H and pesticide safety and all sorts of extension units that are providing public education in the online space. And we can also work with industry partners to provide teacher accounts when necessary. This has also been helpful for some of the partner courses that are going on with schools in Ohio. So we can also provide that teacher role for partners with Ohio State. Part of that though is that the Ohio State sponsored course must be supervised by an extension personnel. So we do require that these basically be run by Ohio State personnel, but we can offer teacher roles and access to the general public as students. The Scarlet Canvas platform also provides a streamlined credit card payment gateway, which provides a easier user experience to enroll and pay for courses. And it gives us a really nice way to accept online payments for folks. We can also use Canvas Analytics in the gradebook to track learner progress and grades. And Scarlet Canvas also has the ability to issue certificates automatically if the completion settings are set up correctly in the course. And we can talk about that later if that's of interest to folks. So let's talk a little bit about the limitations of Scarlet Canvas. So you'll see this picture on the slide that says nope, because if you ask me if Scarlet Canvas will host video, I'm gonna tell you nope, because Scarlet Canvas, while it holds videos, it's not a video player. It doesn't play back to the users very well. So when you want to share videos with your participants, I always recommend utilizing either MediaSite, which is a university enterprise tool for hosting videos, or a university approved YouTube account to host video, because playback of video and the closed captioning experience and the general user experience is not good in ScarletCanvas. In addition, it makes it difficult to protect your videos because the way ScarletCanvas holds them, anyone with access to the video could save it and distribute it somewhere else. So that's not really great for protecting our intellectual property either. The other thing that ScarletCanvas is not great for is hosting public content for anyone. So ScarletCanvas is not a blog. It's not like a county website. So it's not really meant for static content that people just view. And it's not meant to host content for anyone to view. User accounts are required. And so basically ScarletCanvas is for online modules and online courses. And I encourage you all to use the idea of a course loosely. An extension, we know our programs vary widely from like a 3-hour module to a, you know, full day experience to maybe there's a really intense program with, you know, 20 hours of required work. So Canvas can hold all of those different types of things. Canvas is also well-suited to support live events in the sense that it's a great complement for something like a workshop that is hosted through Zoom, but you have PowerPoint slides and different things that you want to provide to your audience. So we've had a few live workshops run really well through Canvas as well, because the instructors were able to utilize not only the registration system, but the ability to share materials with their participants and put that in a single space with their Zoom meeting links and things like that. So when you think about an online program or an online course in Canvas, don't limit yourself to the traditional idea of an academic course. Think of it in the extension context where we might have an event or a series of events or some more robust program experiences that are, you know, several weeks long. So Canvas can flex to all of those opportunities. So we'll move along here and we will take a few minutes to view a video that shows the registration process. So I'm gonna switch my share to a YouTube video that is also available in the instructor community. And I need to get my share screen situated here. So if you are already an instructor in ScarletCanvas, you have access to the ScarletCanvas instructor community. If you begin working in ScarletCanvas, I add everyone who holds an instructor role to this community. Because it allows me to share relevant materials and communicate with you all. So here is the YouTube video. Can everybody see my share screen? Can I get like a thumbs up in the reactions or something?
It looks good.
Okay, cool. So I'm gonna back this up and we'll get this started. Is the audio playing with this?
No, I don't hear the audio.
Okay. Let's see if I can fix this share. Okay, we're going to try a different share method. This is from my computer, so you'll have to let me know if the audio works if or not.
Yep, the audio's good.
In this video, we will demonstrate how to register for a ScarletCanvas course using the catalog self-registration platform in conjunction with the CyberSource credit card payment gateway. This screen shows you what a catalog listing would look like when a participant clicks on the enrollment link. You would then click on the red enrollment button and fill out the resulting form. All fields of this form are required except for the OSU name.number. If an individual does not have a name.number, they do not check the box and they leave the OSU name.number field blank. All users must agree to the acceptable use policy and acknowledge the privacy policy. If your course features promotion codes, the promotion code will be entered and applied here. And then individuals completing the form must fill out the CAPTCHA requirement to ensure that they are not, in fact, a robot. In this instance, the CAPTCHA is asking us to identify crosswalks, so we will do that. Click Verify and proceed to payment. After clicking Proceed to Payment, the credit card form will populate. Fields with an asterisk are required. The user will then select the card type, enter the card number, the expiration date, and click Pay. After entering valid credit card information, the user will then be directed to go check their email for a confirmation message and the course access information. So that is the entire process from start to finish to register for a ScarletCanvas course using Catalog and the CyberSource credit card payment gateway.
Okay, so that was the preview experience. I'm going to grab the YouTube link and just drop it in the chat for everybody. I learn better with closed captions, and the YouTube link will provide that if you'd like to do that as well. The audio share just wasn't working right for me, and I will go back to my PowerPoint again. So the process you just saw shows the entire process for a paid course. If someone were to register with just a free course, they would simply see the first page of that with the enrollment information. The system would bypass the credit card screen, but they would still receive the same account submitted, or like the same enrollment message with that screen that says, go check your email. The other piece that would be missing would be that successful transaction notice. So that's what registration looks like. And we encourage everyone to utilize the registration system for individuals to register themselves, because it's more scalable and sustainable. This has been approved for use with youth audiences for these free courses as well. Obviously, if it were a paid situation, a parent would need to be involved because there's a credit card there. But we are allowed to use this self-registration process for all of our courses, and it really has provided a great streamlined experience for users, and it's scalable for large courses. We have courses supporting over 1,000 users, and it's worked really nicely. I see Doug's question here in the chat. How do we get the payment from a CyberSource payment into one of our county extension office funds? So thank you for that question, Doug. Very relevant. So CyberSource is funneled into a single merchant account. And then on a quarterly basis, I work with the fiscal team to reallocate funds. So the fiscal team will reallocate funds to county extension office cost center that is designated when you request your catalog. So let me, I know we're hopping back and forth between shares here, but let me grab the link for you quickly to submit a catalog listing. Because when you create a course and you're ready to register users, you need that catalog listing form, which I will grab for you quickly. That should take you there, hopefully. The Microsoft Office form links are really ugly, so I have to check. Okay, so that Go link works. And when you're ready to submit for a course catalog listing, you can fill out that form and then I'll create your catalog listing and you can put your cost center in that form. All the information I need to create your catalog listing is in that form. Melissa says, I have a Qualtrics registration process for Nelnet for the course I want to put in Canvas. Can I offer a code to do the registration? Yes. So one workaround we have done for courses that offer purchase orders or checks or scholarships, different things like that, we have promotion codes, so we can set those to be 100% of the amount or a partial amount, and I can create those for you with your listing. That's also, Mary says, where's the link? So I dropped the Go link for the Scarlet catalog request form in the chat there. And I can share it again with everybody at the end of the session if that's helpful for you all to grab it on your way out. But when you enter all the fields in that form, it's everything I need to create your catalog listing, including how you might intend to use promotion codes, and I create those for you. If you're an FCS, John Gladden is your contact for Scarlet catalog listings. I pretty much handle all the others. So that's how the registration process works. Hey, John, thanks for turning on your camera. So John's waving hi to everybody. If you're an FCS, John Gladden, Gladden.9 is your person, and he can set you up with catalog links and such if you need them.
I'll be glad to help.
Thanks, John. And I'll get my PowerPoint going back here. So part of the questions surrounding Scarlet Canvas use and the move from in-person programming to online outreach is, how do I create a space for my non-tech savvy folks? How do I create an engaging space? And we can do that really well by harnessing our existing extension personnel presence. We all know that extension personnel have a certain way to, you know, move a crowd and work a crowd when you're in a face-to-face gathering. And I invite you all to bring that same energy to your online courses and bring your own voice and your own presence to your materials. And you can do that in several ways. I encourage everybody to think about how you might introduce your online courses or modules as far as in the context of how these are important to your participants, how they're relevant to their lives, and you know, maybe some of the aspects that, you know, you personally are passionate about in the course. And I also encourage everybody to do like an introduction video about themselves. Community connection can still be fostered in an online environment if it's done thoughtfully. So one really great way to do that is to have an introduction video for every member that of the team that might be interacting with students. So at a county level, maybe that's, you know, a county educator and a program support staff or something like that. But if you have personnel who will be interacting with this, the participants in the online environment, I highly encourage you to either do an introduction post or a video introducing yourself. And given the nature of your programs or audiences, it might be relevant to open up a discussion board for individuals to participate in and interact with. Certainly be mindful of your audience when you do that. Be sure that if you make that choice, that it's relevant to your course. As an example, the pesticide safety courses are pretty straightforward. These are for Ohio Department of Agriculture certifications. Discussion boards are not really a relevant space there. But perhaps you have Master Gardener volunteers that you would like to allow space to sort of get to know each other and, you know, ask questions. And that might be a good place to use a discussion board. I typically don't recommend discussion boards with youth. Youth can be wild cards, right? So it's a lot for an instructor to keep an eye on. And we want to make sure that we're creating positive spaces for our participants. And so if they're not relevant or not appropriate for your audience, skip the discussion boards. The other item that's available in Canvas, but I typically don't recommend using, is chat, because the chat never really goes away. You can't really truly delete it. So that is probably not the best choice to engage with your users in Canvas, just because it's very permanent. So something you didn't want or posted there, you wouldn't really be able to get rid of it. So I encourage engaging through video and content and voice. You can bring a lot of voice to written content as well when it's done mindfully. I have a great resource, and maybe Shalise, you could pop it in the chat for me and I'll switch my share screen here. It's scifund.org, and it's a really wonderful resource to think about audience first voice. It's a self-guided free class. And what I love about this content is it transcends all platforms. This audience first perspective can be used in flyers and articles and fact sheets, and it can be used in video and in-person programming. So I encourage everyone to explore this and reflect on how you can bring your voice and an audience first perspective to your content. And I've just found this really helpful for myself, because I tend to have a very sciencey voice and dry reporting voice. So I'm trying to work on that myself. And I see a question from Margaret: where is chat in Scarlet Canvas course? I believe it's, so in some courses you'll see it, if you're an instructor, you'll see it in the left-hand side in the settings, and I can showcase a course right now. So let me just, move over here. Oh, it looks like the chat is gone now. That might've been an update. I think they realized that the chat wasn't a great feature to keep. So chat is no longer, oh, I think it's called collaborations, is the one that I'm thinking of. So this brings me kind of to another perspective of creating a user-friendly and engaging experience. We want the engagement with the course to be positive. We don't want it to be frustrating, and we don't want it to be confusing, right? So one of the best ways to do that is to hide everything that a user doesn't need. Don't give them the opportunity to get lost. Don't give them the opportunity to get confused by restricting what they have access to. And so the collaboration space is something that I typically disable in all courses. And I'm going to show you what that looks like. I'm in, at this point, an admin view, but this is similar to an instructor view in Canvas. And you'll notice that all of these tabs have this slash through the eye, which means they're disabled. And when you turn on student view, all of these things disappear. And this course was designed to be very linear because they were working with an audience that was new to the learning management system, new to learning through technology. This is the commercial pesticide applicator recertification course. And so we worked to design a course that was very straightforward and difficult to get lost in. So they hid everything except the homepage. When you access this course as a student, you're dropped immediately into this content and it says start here. So I recommend that for all courses is a start here module, which in this case contains some relevant information to pesticide applicator licenses. In your case, it might contain something else, whether that's some Canvas help documentation showing folks how to get started, whether that is related resources or maybe some list of requirements for successfully completing the course. I also encourage you to include like an introduction to the instructors, contact information for where to get help. We have some standard language that goes in every catalog listing for technical questions like, I lost my password, what do I do now? But I also encourage a course level contact for course questions. So if someone can't get a quiz to work, the best place to start there would be with the instructor because the instructor knows that course and knows that content. But when a student gets into a course like this, they can open the first item and they basically just click next and move through the course in a really linear fashion. And if they were to click home, it takes them back. And there's some check boxes to where they've been. And as they move through the course, this course utilizes a really nice feature called completion requirements and prerequisites. So you can set requirements to consider each module complete. So maybe in each module, they need to read a page, watch a video, and take a quiz. And you can set the module to require that they complete all those items and that they get a passing score on the quiz. You can also set it to be locked, so everything has to be viewed in sequential order. This is also a great feature for folks who might be prone to getting lost in an online environment, because we pretty much force the order and we force the linear format. And when we do that, it just really takes away a lot of the confusion. The other recommendation I have is that you structure all of your modules in a similar format. So try not to skip around a lot as far as make sure every module has a similar layout for video pages, has similar instructions for assignments, and basically just has a really consistent format. The consistency helps people figure out where they are and helps prevent them from getting confused. Let me check my notes here. So the other item I wanted to make sure that I touch on is one other element of creating engaging and user-friendly content is to create accessible content. And accessible content is content that allows users with different needs to interact with the content independently. Some really basic stuff to consider would be color contrast. You want to make sure that all of your PowerPoint decks, all of your font color choices, have adequate color contrast, so anyone with limited vision would still be able to see that. I mean, let's think about our extension audiences, right? Like a lot of times we have some older folks who might have bifocals or trifocals, or you know, just have some limited vision issues. And by designing these materials in a way that more people can read them easily, that's gonna lead to a better user experience. The other consideration for digital accessibility is screen reader friendly documents and closed captions for videos, including transcripts and video descriptions. There's lots of steps we can take to improve course accessibility. And the beautiful thing about improving course accessibility is it improves the learner experience overall. It's kind of like the idea of like curb cutouts or ramps, right? Like, so, you know, we might think they're primarily utilized for a person in a wheelchair, but someone pulling like a heavy rolling backpack, or someone with a stroller, or someone who, you know, just has arthritis and their knees hurt would, you know, benefit from not having to use the stairs. So it's kind of the same principle in digital accessibility. When we improve accessibility, we improve the experience for everyone. And one resource I really wanted to showcase today is this beautiful website from Digital Accessibility Services that includes a ton of information surrounding digital accessibility, including links to more training content on how to produce digital, like accessible digital content. And those are training modules in Buckeye Learn. So when you click on this producing accessible digital content page, it takes you down to all these training and resources. So there's a ton of great stuff in here, and I encourage everyone to look through these and to complete the training as you have time. And in addition, the Digital Accessibility Services website has a list of our coordinator contacts. Our college coordinator is Eric Owens. There's also a great page that shows the hiring a captioning supplier process. And if you are doing like a Zoom webinar workshop and you want to use Canvas as well, do make sure that you're still getting your accessibility exception request filled out for your Zoom webinar workshop. And in general, it is the expectation that we build accessible content in ScarletCanvas. There's another really great resource. Let me find it quickly here. I actually posted it in the ScarletCanvas community. Thanks for dropping that link, Shalise. I appreciate it. Let me go back to the ScarletCanvas community and I will grab the other link that's really helpful to work through some accessible stuff. What about using YouTube's caption? Celeste, that's a great question. So yes, if you have an approved YouTube account, you can upload your videos to YouTube to get that baseline caption. But what you also need to do is edit those closed captions. 98% accuracy is the standard to meet ADA requirements. So that does usually require some manual editing to make sure we meet that accuracy level. The other thing you can do too is to post if you were to embed a YouTube video in a ScarletCanvas course, you can also post a link to the transcript by putting the transcript in the files. And that's another way to help support that digital accessibility. So this is the link that I was looking for to help you improve digital accessibility in your Canvas courses. The Office of Distance Education and E-Learning put together this really great kind of top 5 list for creating accessible materials in Canvas. So I encourage you all to peruse that as well as the Digital Accessibility Services website. And if you have additional digital accessibility policy questions that are more detailed in nature that I don't know, you can take take those to Eric Owens because he is our digital accessibility coordinator. And he works directly with the accessibility office to make sure that we're staying on top of all the guidelines and expectations. So if you're in Canvas and you are an instructor, do take some time to also check out other resources I've posted for accessibility, including this contrast checker. And I'm gonna drop this too for everybody. Even if you're not a ScarletCanvas instructor, this is a really handy resource to explore. If you're creating really any digital content, whether that's a PowerPoint deck or a PDF, you can put in colors from the brand palette, make sure they're accessible as a foreground and background color. And it the website takes some time to explain what all these terms mean. So you don't need to know what the terms mean. The explanations live on here and you can reference them anytime you need as far as how the color contrast checker runs against these accessibility standards and what they mean when they say large text or graphical object or whichever. So that's kind of the basics of accessibility. Before we move on to creating engaging courses, or move away from this aspect of the presentation, are there any more questions about creating engaging content or accessible content that I could address? Not seeing any hands raised or any questions in the chat, so we'll keep moving. It would help if I reshared my screen. Hang on here. So, the next question is, where do I learn how to do more in Canvas? Before I show you some of what I have in mind, for those of you who put an intermediate user in Canvas, or those of you who've been working in Canvas, maybe you're still a beginner, how are you currently getting answers to your questions about Canvas? Okay, well, anyone's thinking about answering the question I just posed, call John, email Amy. Yes, that's kind of the trend we've seen. and that's great, we're happy to be a resource. I got a question here from Melissa that I think is really valid and goes back to our conversations about video hosting. So Melissa asks, if we create a welcome video, what platform should we utilize for ease of use and integration? So Melissa, if you have access to a university approved YouTube account, I would recommend YouTube. If you don't have access to a university approved YouTube account, I recommend MediaSite, which is mediasite.osu.edu, I believe. Let me stop share and I'll pull up MediaSite for everyone to kind of get a look at. MediaSite is the video hosting solution for the university. The benefit of it is it's an enterprise tool, so it's supported. You can get some assistance with that platform. It's passed the security checks. The downside to MediaSite is it's not as intuitive for us as instructors to use as YouTube, and it's also not quite as robust of a playback experience for users, but I think overall it's been working pretty well for the courses that have been utilizing it. Because MediaSite does allow you to embed videos in a Canvas course. So it's still a really great option. Thanks, Shalise, for dropping that link for me. So here's MediaSite. So when you get into MediaSite, you log in with your Ohio State name dot number. Everybody should have a free account. And that's another beautiful thing about MediaSite, since it's provided by the university, it's free. And you can click add presentation up here in the right hand corner and just upload a new video. So if you've created a video and saved it from Zoom to your computer, you can upload it here. Though the other downside of MediaSite is it doesn't generate those captions for you. So you would need the closed caption file from Zoom to add that to your video, whereas YouTube will put the captions on it for you. Regardless of presentation format, the captions do need to be 98% accurate to meet our accessibility standard requirement. But MediaSite does offer the ability to embed a video in a course. And I'll just show you really quickly what that looks like in Scarlett, just with one of the modules that I've built in the instructor community. So here is the customer perspective video that I was trying to share earlier. So this is what an embedded video looks like in Canvas. And it's nice because participants don't have to leave the platform to watch this video. They can stay in Canvas, which helps keep them from getting lost. I have noticed that if users participate in a course from their mobile devices, which we're seeing a lot more of, it does take them to the YouTube app. But building your course in this fashion where the information is on pages and you're using embedded videos, as opposed to a lot of documents and PowerPoint slide decks, does make your course more of a mobile first design. And mobile first design is also really nice to optimize the user experience across devices. So if you've designed it for a mobile device where you're using Canvas pages, limiting the use of documents and PDF files, and you're trying to keep everything in-house in Canvas, that generally works better for folks on computers too. So that mobile first premise is a really good one to work on. Could these website links be shared via email? Yeah, we can put together a follow-up email, thanks Shalise, and distribute these. And if you are in the Canvas course for instructors already, I also have a page designated to mobile app design best practices and tips for technology novice audiences. So I recommend you review those as well. And we saw the folks that were nice enough to communicate with us in chat about how they get help right now, trial and error, email me or John. I would also like to direct you all to the instructor guides from Canvas. I'm gonna drop the direct link here if you'd like to copy and paste it now. Otherwise, we will also include this in our follow-up email. So this is the list of basically all the help documentation that Canvas has built for instructors. It can be a little overwhelming, but they have this nice table of contents at the top. So I recommend looking through this by topic as you work through these help guides. So I get a lot of questions about how to build quizzes. So let's just take a look at some of the quiz documentation. Now, if you are looking at quiz documentation for your own courses, our Scarlett Canvas website uses quizzes, not new quizzes. So this quizzes area is where you will be looking. And one of the more popular questions that I get is related to options in a quiz. So we'll look at what options can I set in a quiz. And I'll make this a little bit bigger for everybody because, oh yeah, usually I run a little bigger with my screen and I must have zoomed out. So here is kind of what the help documentation would look like for options in a quiz. And these options can be really handy for courses that are large and they need to kind of run themselves. Because you can set the quizzes to allow a certain number of attempts. So you can set it to unlimited if they need to just get a passing score. You can also set due dates, and you can set whether they can see one question at a time or if students are allowed to see correct answers. So this is a really popular help document link that you might want to peruse. As I opened this, I also realized one other popular question we see is related to module settings. So I'm going to go back to the instructor guide and show you where to find the module guides. So we're back at that main link that I dropped in the chat. And if you scroll through this table of contents, which is organized in alphabetical order, there's the modules, and you can add module settings. Let's see if I can find the help document that is most related to what I'm after. How do I add requirements to a module? So this is one of the popular questions too, because passing quiz scores are a popular setting. And rightfully so, because you can then restrict access to the next module without having to have any instructor interventions if you set your quiz to automatically grade. So the add requirements to a module documentation shows you how to use different features in the settings to stipulate what the students are expected to do with this material. You can also use this to lock modules by date if you're running a course that runs on a specific calendar. So that's a useful way to utilize module settings. And so you can set the requirement that students complete all of these things. And this is where the sequential order comes in that I was talking about earlier. So these are kind of the settings you use to restrict what students are expected to do, to view. You can also set that the assignment be submitted or a certain quiz score be reached. And we have a couple great questions here in the chat. Doug is asking, is there a way to require that they watch an embedded YouTube video all the way through to the end? So the answer to that is technically no. So we don't really have a great way to force video viewing, because with YouTube videos, they can click play and then they can keep going. I'll show you kind of how that looks in our Canvas course here for instructors. So a person could either play this video or not, and they'd click next and it would be marked as done. The reality of this though is there's really no great way to force users to watch a video, because the other way would be to create a SCORM file, which requires specific content authoring software. And then the SCORM file can be imported into Canvas as an assignment, and you can set a percentage required to view. But I've worked with students long enough to know that that doesn't stop them from clicking play and walking away from their computer to get themselves a snack. So there's really no way to force them to watch the video. But yes, Melissa, you're right on that. The knowledge check is where we get to the point that it says, did you really learn this content or not? So I often encourage a knowledge check quiz with every module or interspersed throughout the course. Like if you have a lot of small pieces of content, certainly I don't think it's appropriate to build a quiz for every video clip. But if you have modules where there's three video clips on a single topic, I do recommend building a knowledge quiz for each module or even for the course, because the reality is we need to know that they learned the content, right? And life is open book. So I encourage you to think about how you can write questions that require critical thinking and application skills, especially for some of these technical certification courses that we have. But basic knowledge check is often sufficient for some of the stuff that we're running as well. So knowledge check quizzes are a great way to do that. Right, Doug. Yeah. So it would be nice if we were able to better monitor that. I will say there's an activity monitor in the people page of a course. If you go to the people page, I'm going to use a different course for this example, just because of how big that roster is. So we'll go to this test course I have. We have a few people in here. There's total activity time, but that can get skewed because I found that users on a mobile device that leave Canvas for the YouTube app, Canvas kind of stops tracking their activity time, so it reflects lower. And then on the opposite end of the spectrum, if a person forgets to sign out, it'll show like hundreds of hours of activity if they do that several times over. So I don't really recommend relying on the total activity time as a good measure, but it does tell you if someone never signed in. Like this Brutus Buckeye account I created as a test, that's not a real account. So you can tell this person's never signed in and Brutus has done nothing in the course. So the activity log is useful for some things. And then Margaret, can you demonstrate grading a participant's work? Sure, there's two ways to go about grading work, and it kind of depends on the layout of of the course and how many people are in it that would determine the best way to handle it. If all of your course assignments are technically quizzes, I recommend going to the quiz and you click on the name and then you can get into the speed grader over here after opening up the quiz settings. And for larger courses, this can be a little bit cumbersome to work through by going through this whole list. For smaller courses, it's not that big of a deal to get through this list. The other way to access the gradebook that might be a little bit faster in certain instances, if you have a lot of students, you can search the gradebook for your students. And so here's one of my test accounts. And then you can view you can click on there. I'm sorry, my video pod's in the way. You can click on this little icon in the gradebook column. So this is a test quiz. And then you can actually access the speed grader. And let's say you had like five quizzes for this one student that you wanted to look at. You can open those in a new tab to kind of more quickly open up several. That said, you do want to make sure that you save all of this and close the tab before you go to the next. Sometimes we see some issues when someone tries to work in too many tabs in Scarlet at once. But this is another way for you to kind of work through the grades is by going to your specific person in the gradebook using the search feature. And then you could click across the gradebook to access all these quizzes. Margaret, does that help? You're welcome to elaborate some more by unmuting yourself or typing in the chat if that does not address your question.
Well, Mike, I'm trying to figure out a way to grade the successful co-parenting in a quicker way. And so I'm looking for, they have several, you know, quizzes and need to respond to those prompts and go from, you know, quiz one to quiz two to quiz three to quiz four without, in an easy manner. And I have never been able to figure it out. So I was hoping you could.
So I would try this approach where you search for your participant in the gradebook, and then you click on this little arrow icon and you open up this option on the right-hand panel and it says Speed Grader. If you right-click on Speed Grader and click Open Link in New Tab, then you can open several quizzes at once and flip through the tabs. I think that might be a faster workflow. I would just be sure that you save each quiz that you grade as you go. Don't edit them all and then go save them all. So if you save each one as you go, I think it'll work fine.
I don't have a grade book on the successful co-parenting on the left side. I have home modules, pages, people, files, syllabus, conferences, but I have grades.
That's it, it's the grades. So if you click on grades, it'll take you to the grade book.
Oh, even though it, okay, now I, oh, geez. Okay, even though it said that it was marked off with the eye. Okay, all right.
Right, yeah, so just when it's marked off with the eye, it just means that it's not visible to students, but it's still accessible to an instructor.
Okay, but does it have a search? Yeah, it does have a search. Okay, so I can start typing the individual's name.
Yep.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, happy to help. And speaking of navigation, links, and settings, I'll take a quick moment to demonstrate the best practice that I was talking about here, because since this is a test course and nobody's in here, I've actually never done that before. I've never actually bothered to move the navigation. So when you get into the settings of a course, you click on the settings in the left, there's this navigation tab up in the middle. And all you have to do to hide things, like this chat, for example, is to drag and drop it here. And then when I click save, it takes the chat out of to hide them from students. And you can also do that with anything else. So I really recommend doing this for anything they don't absolutely need, even pages and files, because pages and files are not always organized in a meaningful way for students, because we as instructors are the ones typically utilizing pages and files. So I highly recommend hiding the pages and files from students, because generally speaking, all that information is going to be presented in a much more meaningful fashion in the modules. And John just dropped some more Speed Grader info there. So that might be useful to some folks as well. And Anne asks, are there any shortcuts for checking off required discussion posts? So if you're checking discussion posts simply for completion and you're not really reading them for content, if you set it up as a graded discussion, so when you build a discussion, so this is just a Q&A forum. Nobody's using it. So I'm going to edit the settings. And there's this setting called graded in the options. And I'll just put 5 points possible on it, because for today's purposes, they're arbitrary. But you can set up where they belong in assignment groups and different things like that. So if you have assignments for certain modules, you can assign them that way, or you don't even need to use groups if you don't want to. But so now that I've made this a points-based discussion, you can go to the gradebook and you'll see that this now populates in the gradebook. And when a student has submitted something, there's like a little discussion bubble that shows up here. And since no one submitted anything, you know, you would know that these are zeros. So if you're not grading on content, that would be the fastest way to identify who submitted a discussion post and who didn't. But that doesn't get you past the hurdle of dealing with the quality of the discussion post. So I do not recommend discussion posts for really large classes because they are time consuming to grade. This is really great discussion. I'm appreciating the questions that you all are submitting here. I'm happy to continue fielding them if there's more. The other thing that I can show you too quickly about getting help in Canvas is if you're a person who likes video, there is there are video guides in Canvas, and let me grab that link. I personally kind of like the help documentation. Here's the Canvas video guide. But if you're a person who learns best through video, they've got a pretty robust set of video guides as well. And if you're looking for documentation to provide your students, they also have some nice little overview videos, like this Canvas overview video for students that gives them a little tutorial. If you expect your users to have a ton of trouble, you might even provide this video in like an email or something if you have access to the roster, which you can get through the Canvas gradebook, actually. So thanks for joining us, Margaret. I'm glad you're able to make it today. So that's another strategy as well, is to reach out to students through Canvas. So let's say you wanted to share this video with them. You could copy this link and go back to Canvas. Oops, I have buried us in the rabbit hole of Canvas. Hang on. So there's two ways to do this: through the inbox, which is kind of like Canvas's email feature, which is nice because then you don't have to grab everybody's email. You can select a course. And I'll just use this template course as an example. And then you can send it to everyone in the course and you can say, you know, getting started in Canvas video. And then this, you know, you could send them a welcome note and then like, here's how to use Canvas, because they may not know. And this allows you direct access to their email inbox as long as they've verified their account. So if they've set up their account, this inbox feature is a really great way to reach out to your entire class and invite them back into the platform to help them get themselves working in the space. And if you're really stuck and you don't know how to do something, try Googling your exact question. Because Google is really great, and whoever tagged all of the instructor guides at Canvas, they did a really great job tagging them all. So they are search engine optimized. They're pretty easy to find through a search engine, especially Google. Yes, Google is your friend, and I recommend everybody give that a go. And speaking of friends with Canvas, if you're new to Canvas, you may not know this yet. The preferred browsers for Canvas are Google Chrome, Microsoft Firefox, or not Microsoft Firefox, Mozilla Firefox, and Safari. You can use Microsoft Edge. It does not support Explorer. So if you find yourself with participants who come to you and say, I can't see anything, I don't understand what I can't see anything. We've noticed that that's usually folks trying to use Explorer or some other very outdated web browser. That's another issue we've kind of seen. And if you need help with ScarletCanvas and searching Google and the instructor guides aren't really helping, and then you can reach out to your ScarletCanvas admin, which would be me at Kohmetscher.1, or if you're in FCS, that's John Gladden, Gladden.9. And let's see, if you happen to be working on a pesticide safety course, then you can reach out to me still. So anyway, it'd be me mostly. And then if you're in FCS, John Gladden. Thanks for dropping your email there, John. That's basically what I have for today. I'm happy to field any other questions, concerns, challenges. Examples of pages that are designed or laid out well. Sure. And I see Celeste has a hand up. So Celeste, you're welcome to type in the chat, unmute.
Yeah, or did you want to do that other one first, or shall I go ahead?
I'll start with Doug's, I guess, and then we'll have you chime in next. So Doug, I've got myself lost. Too many tabs open. So let me find a template course. Or no, I'll go back. I tend to like pages that include like a picture and text, and always make sure that you're pictures have alt text on them. Let me go find a template course, because I do have some templates that I'm working on for everyone. Okay, this one's mine. So one of the things that I like to do is build an overview page for every module. So this has like learning objectives. For courses that aren't as heavy in content, you could get rid of some of this stuff here, like these reading and reference materials. I also like graded assignments, or you could even put like required assignments or required quizzes, and any reminders. So if you have a hybrid course going where there's some work that they do online and then there's like a live Zoom session, the reminders is a great place to tell people that, you know, we are meeting on, you know, Thursday, or we're meeting on such and such date. Now, I do caution everyone from putting too many specific dates in, because then that's a lot of editing as you move those courses forward. The other pages I have is a sample video content page, where it's just a title, some basic instructions, a link to a Q&A. Slides that are used in this video can be found here, and you would insert a link to the slides in the files, and then you provide the transcript link, and then you just have the video here that would have closed captioning. So if you would like to have access to a template page, let me know, and I can get you access to that. The main thing is once you decide upon a layout, that you keep it consistent throughout the course. Celeste, do you want to go ahead and ask your question?
Sure. I guess I just want to know about videos. If you had any thoughts about from what you're talking about, either media site or YouTube, you're talking about streaming as the basic format. And one thing with some, you know, this is more for class, you know, campus classes. When the pandemic first hit, we sometimes had students who were, you know, had really, really poor connections out somewhere in the boonies. So we were trying to provide videos both, you know, in the normal streaming format and also downloadable, even though that, you know, it was more work to do that. So have you found, you know, especially for extension, is usually streaming pretty much okay for people anywhere? And I, of course, it's sort of related to length, you know, it would be for longer videos where the size gets even more of an issue. But, you know, so what are your thoughts about providing downloadable?
So I think, so in general, I know there are areas that struggle with connectivity, the Appalachian region. Some folks can't even get like data cell service at their homes. So it is a valid concern in some areas. Limiting that video length to 5 minutes or so is really an easy way to help with those that have connectivity, but it's slow. So certainly if you're dealing with an audience that you know is going to have an issue with connectivity, then I could see the merit of offering. You can set files in Canvas to be available to only certain people. So you could upload the videos. Now I will say Canvas has really limited space. So this, I'm going to backtrack a little bit. I don't think that's the best route to share videos in a downloadable format. I think it would be best to put them in Microsoft OneDrive and then share that link to people who truly can't access the videos otherwise. Now that said, there are some accessibility concerns with that because if they download the videos, they're not going to have the ability to, utilize the closed captions, because the only way to do that would be to burn the closed captions on the video, and that can frustrate some users because it creates kind of cognitive overload. Or you ask them to download a really complicated packet of files that would play the video with closed captions, but they're probably going to get confused as to which file they're supposed to open and then not be able to open the video. So you could provide the downloadable MP4 in a transcript file, but you would need an exception request on file to meet accessibility requests or like accessibility standards with that. John, that's right. The Canvas course quota for file storage is 500 megabits. So that you can reach really fast with video. So that's the problem, is we don't really have a lot of storage space in Canvas for videos, which is why I don't like to use Canvas for video. So you could put them in OneDrive and share that link to specific folks, but I would do that as a last resort because it doesn't offer the best playback experience. So Anne saying they've got a module page appears linked in one module and it changes them in another. My guess would be that you've got the same page reposted in several modules because you would need to like copy that page. So it would be module one overview, module two overview. So they're not the same page because you can repost the same page in Canvas, but you're right, when you edit it once, it edits the instance of that page in the whole course. So, and I can help you troubleshoot that if that doesn't help. If you're using YouTube and have closed captions and posted the link in Canvas, do you still need to post the Zoom transcript? Yes, you should still provide a link to the transcript. So I would recommend putting the links or the transcript files themselves in files and then posting the link to that file in your Canvas course, because that's best practice for our accessibility expectations. And usually we just post those transcript files as text files. Does that answer everybody's questions? If you have additional questions, I'm happy to take, we've got like 15 minutes left here. You wanna, you know, jet out early and have 15 minutes back in your calendar, That's great. We appreciate you being here. If you've got more questions, I'm happy to stay and keep answering them. Yeah, and I can demo how to post a profile picture in Canvas. Let me share my screen. So when you're logged into Canvas, if you click on your account, it'll open up this menu that says settings. And in settings, you can, oh yeah, you click on the circle where either the little avatar is or an existing picture, and there's this little pencil icon that pops up, and then you can upload a picture or take a picture from your webcam. And I'm just gonna leave mine there because I kind of like that one. But yeah, you hover over the little circle next to your name and then click the pencil to open up that box to add a picture. Oh, great point, John. We can reach out to Office of Distance Education and e-learning for variable bitrate streaming on the media site videos. That's a great option to request that. That's a great option to request.
In successful co-parenting, we had a couple videos that we tested on a slow connection, and we found the video was kind of choppy. And then we discovered that we can request a variable bitrate streaming from the video gurus at ODE. And that seemed to help.
That's really nice. Good. That's a great option for MediaSite, because I know that's kind of been an issue since it's not as responsive to connection speeds as YouTube.
I think other services like YouTube, it's like built in, but in MediaSite,
it's more automatic.
Yeah.
Amy, I had just a quick question on that. You mentioned at the beginning there was a form for Zoom webinars that relates to accessibility, and I don't use that format too often, so could you explain what that form is?
Sure. So that's an accessibility exception request form. It should be used anytime that we have services or content that's not accessible that we're offering, which is part of the reason that digital accessibility considerations are so important when we're building courses. But since Zoom closed captioning, even the built-in feature, doesn't meet the ADA requirement, it's really common to request an exception request for that. So let me grab that link for you. So if you need to submit an exception request, it's at this track-gac. It's really an obscure link, but do set up a time to meet with your accessibility coordinator, which for College of Food, Ag, and Environmental Sciences is Eric Owens, to walk through that form, because the desired verbiage and expected verbiage in those exception request updates sometimes based on guidelines, and those forms track much faster if they're done properly up front. So if you need to submit an exception request, meet with Eric Owens. Last I knew, they recommended a 6-week lead time on those, so do be sure to plan ahead.
Okay, thanks, Debbie. I see Debbie posted a question. So if we're going to do a series of Zoom meetings or webinars, she said, then you would submit that form before you would put those on for the public. Is that right?
Right, right. So you need the exception request on file before you even market the webinar or workshop or series of meetings. And then that way you have your documentation in place to hire a closed caption vendor or an interpreter if you were like an American Sign Language interpreter, if you were to get some sort of request.
If there's no other questions, Amy, I'm going to stop the recording.
Yep. I think we're done. I think the silence means that we've